This program, the final of the calendar year, will be unconventional. We propose to spend the time with three guests probably more familiar than any others to the viewers of the program. All of them have appeared as principals, and all of them have appeared as examiners. Jeff Greenfield has probably appeared on over 100 firing line programs, beginning as a panelist years ago. Allard Lowenstein has the record, along with Mr. Brzezinski, as guests, and Harriet Pilpel is not far behind. I regret to remind you that all three are well-known American liberals. Mr. Greenfield was off to a precocious start by joining the staffs of Senator Robert Kennedy and Mayor John Lindsay after graduating from the law school at Yale, and before that the University of Wisconsin, where he served as editor of the paper. He's now a freelance writer, reviewer, and critic whose next book, Playing Politics for Keeps, will appear in June. Allard Lowenstein has served as a professor of law, as president of the Americans for Democratic Action, as an ambassador to the United Nations, as U.S. representative to the Human Rights Commission, as congressman from Long Island, and is the author of a famous indictment of South African politics written 20 years ago. Harriet Pilpel is a practicing attorney with the firm of Greenbaum, Wolf, and Ernst, and has served literally dozens of committees devoted to women's rights, birth control, and civil rights. She has written on marriage and family law, is a graduate of Columbia and of Vassar College, and the recipient of many awards. I propose to touch on three, possibly four, major developments of the year. The first is, of course, Iran, its causes and solutions. The second is inflation. The third, the developing political scene. And fourth, if there is time, and we may well elect not to make time for the prospects for the survival of self-government. I'd like to begin by asking Mrs. Pilpel whether she agrees with Arthur Schlesinger, Jr., who wrote this morning in the New York Times, that he believes the country is mischievously wrong in its apparent decision to get behind the president in his handling of the emergency.
I don't think that I would sum it up that way, but I'm in a unique position to do it because I haven't read it. I only have heard references to it. If what Arthur Schlesinger is saying is that it is important that we debate all significant public issues, this is a significant public issue, and therefore, without opposing the president in any sense, we begin to ask questions. I think that's healthy for a democracy, and if that's what he said, I do agree with him.
No, I don't think he's saying anything quite that banal, though I wouldn't put it past him. What he is saying is that we must detach the issue of the Shah from the issue of the prisoners, that our almost self-consciously methodological failure to do so, i.e., we're not going to discuss the Shah, we're going to discuss whether you have any right to take American hostages, that our failure to decouple those two points and treat them individually has the effect of worsening our situation in Tehran. Here's what he would like. He would like us to denounce the Shah officially in accents at least as emphatic as Teddy Kennedy's, and on the grounds of doing, having done that, to seek to ingratiate ourselves with the people who have the physical power to hold our prisoners.
My only response to that is that I think they are two issues, that if I was sure that separating them would not injure the hostages in any way, I think it would be healthy to discuss them separately. And we have not, on the whole, done that.
Well, do you have no sort of doctrinal position on whether you will agree to the terms imposed on you by blackmail?
I don't understand the question.
Well, a marvelous example is Israel and the PLO. Israel says, we're perfectly prepared to recognize the PLO the day the PLO says that they are prepared to coexist with Israel.
Yes.
But we are not going to discuss anything with you until that moment. Now, do you think that's a silly position?
No, I do not think that's
a silly
position.
Well, why is that not comparable?
I don't think it's at all comparable, because in this particular situation, the two issues are actually independent.
No, they're not.
Well, the people in Iran are trying to make them one issue, but they are actually two issues.
Well, of course they are two issues, But isn't it correct for the United States government to take the position that it doesn't matter what the Shah did or didn't do, they have no right to intrude into the embassy, seize our representatives, and hold them hostages.
But that isn't inconsistent with what I understood you to say, Schlesinger just said. That is a perfectly reasonable position, which I would support. But is there anything wrong with, at the same time, considering the question of the Shah?
Well, it would clearly be perceived as our having capitulated to their idea of an appropriate hierarchy of concerns.
If the free access,
we are not in a position where we need to are we? Where we need to make formal judgments on the Shah. Well, Arthur Schlesinger can write a book about him. If Teddy doesn't win, he'd have to write a book about something else, and he can give a historical verdict on the Shah. But we aren't a running tribunal to pass judgment on the historical performance of deposed leaders.
I think that's. I will just like to say, I think that's a very unfair way of putting it. If by the exercise of free speech and free press in this country, which should apply to all subject matter, we may give aid and comfort to our enemies, I would still be in favor of the exercise of free speech and free press. And I think that Mr. Schlesinger has lots of things to write about besides the Shah, and he has chosen to do that because there has been a certain inhibition on the discussion of the Iranian situation prior to this time for fear that it would hurt the hostages.
Well, I
think what he said, what Arthur Schlesinger's piece said, is that if there were public discussion on the questions raised by the seizure of the hostages, it would be clear that there is unanimity among Americans on the question that we will not yield to blackmail, and that therefore a public discussion would not be counter to the unity that we have to display, but that the fact that there is criticism of discussion suggests that there is a sort of enforced unanimity where it doesn't exist. And I think actually if we looked at it from the perspective of a distant patience, we've been a month of prayer, and people who haven't prayed in a long time, I think, have done that because of their concern for the human beings involved in this terrible situation. We've shown a greater unanimity of feeling than we have in a long time as a people. Governor Reagan, on the other hand, in the course of that, and I think without doing any violence to that unanimity of feeling, has suggested that the Shah should be our guest here in perpetuity, as it were. Andrew Young, who was late our ambassador at the UN and presumably still close to President Carter, has spoken of the Shah in very, very hostile terms. I think he called him a torturer and a murderer and said that Khomeini was a brilliant man. There was comment from him on these questions. My sense of it is that it is better to accept the fact that people are going to discuss questions about this, in the course of which, no matter how they may differ on subsidiary questions, they agree entirely on the fact that there cannot be any yielding to the blackmail, there cannot be any discussion of terms regarding anything else until those hostages are out, and that what I think Arthur Schlesinger was saying is that the sense that, say, Kennedy did something inappropriate in discussing this when others have already been discussing it is a misperception of what he did and of what the country should do. And I would like to say, and I think for all of us here, that there is no deviation that I know of on the part of anybody in this country that would suggest lack of unity on the central question that you're concerned about. But there may be, and probably ought to be, a discussion on questions that do not distort our perception of other issues raised by foreign policy questions. And I'm sure that Ronald Reagan would agree that his statement was appropriate in trying to get people to focus not on where we would divide later, but on what things have led up to this and how we can behave to show that democracy is strong enough to encounter this kind of atrocious misconduct on the part of other people without giving up our basic intelligence and our basic right to discuss our policies.
Well, I think, you see, in the first place, everybody is free, correct, to say anything they want to about the Shah, and people do.
Right.
Every day we've seen lots of letters. In fact, people are free to say we ought to ship them home and get the people back. I've seen that in the New York Times and elsewhere. Schlesinger is really talking to, as he put it himself, the establishment. There is an apparent consensus that the leaders, people who are trying to be presidents concretely, oughtn't at this moment to get into this argument, because to do so is to suggest to Iran that there is something less than a collective support. But
on the PLO question,
although it's awfully tempting because the Shah's rule comes more to our attention in the light of these events to talk about him, to do so under these circumstances suggests to me an indelicacy.
Well, but that the problem with that is, and is that it seems once again to be that the one time we are told we ought not to discuss something is the time when it comes to the front burner. It's equivalent to saying, whatever the reasons why we got involved in position X, now that we are at the crisis point, it is futile to discuss how we got there, for we must preserve national unity. Part of the problem is whether that argument is appropriate or not now. It has in the past been used to ill purpose in this country. I would argue,
like
most
when?
I think most recently in Vietnam, we were told when American troops were committed.
You're not suggesting to me that there wasn't a discussion of Vietnam.
Not only am I not suggesting it, that's specifically not what I said. What happens is, at a flashpoint, we are told by a lot of people, don't bring this up now because it will appear that the country is divided. The time to discuss the origins of X, whatever X is not now. I must say, I cannot recall, historically or in my lifetime, a time when so little dissent from the fundamental premise of this was an evil deed by a foreign power and it has to be ended by whatever means seem appropriate has happened. I mean, there just is no dissent on that issue, save for a letter in the New York Times by a couple of radicals who would dissent on the colors of the American flag. But that is very, and by the way, I don't think there's any argument that whatever the Shah was, it has no bearing on what the Khomeini government or lack of government did, which is outrageous.
Can I just say at that point that your analogy to the PLO seems to me to strengthen what I believe would be the proper process now, because the Israeli government not dealing with the PLO is the equivalent of the United States government not dealing until the Shah is released on other questions.
Until
the hostage is released. That does not mean that there isn't room in Israel, as there is, a discussion of what ultimately will happen in the event that the PLO renounces its tactics and accepts Israel. Discussion can go on the part of citizens of any stature without undermining the central feeling, when, in fact, that central feeling is unanimous without it being enforced by silence on those who might disagree. And I would expect that the feeling, it seems to me there was once a time when the Chesapeake was seized, I think in 1807, by the British during the period before the Second War for Independence. And they, as I recall it, impressed several American seamen into the British Navy and hung several people that they found on the Chesapeake that they felt had committed crimes against the British government. And this country was then, as now, I think, horrified and united, and properly so. Yet there was a great deal of discussion as to what the proper response was to that kind of misconduct by, at that time, the British. So I think we have precedent for agreement.
What an appropriate response is.
Absolutely, yeah.
And there was a certain amount of discussion of that here. Mm-hmm. Limited only by the inherent limitations of what, in fact, we can do.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But there is that. I don't know that somebody seeking political power in Israel would feel absolutely free to come out in favor of recognizing the PLO.
Well, see,
which doesn't mean that a columnist can't talk
about
it.
No, but has anyone in this country come out in favor of yielding to blackmail? That's seeking power. I mean, I think the analogy stops when you consider what it is. I don't think Governor Reagan is doing that, or Senator Kennedy, or anyone else.
Well, what Kennedy did was, in effect, criticize Carter for permitting the Shah to enter this country and go on to urge him to kick him out. He said this is not a dumping ground for totalitarians.
Well, is the point, though, I mean, I find it interesting that John Connolly, who I think is on nobody's list of doctrinaire liberals, said that Ronald Reagan's statement that the Shah should have asylum was more provocative than Senator Kennedy's. In fact, criticized it more. But I go ahead.
I'm just going to say I am very concerned about withdrawing any subject from the realm of discussion. And if we did that in response to pressures from a totalitarian regime on either side, whether it were the Shah or the Khomeini regime, we would really have surrendered something of great value to us. It is clear to me that the way we function and the way we have really vindicated our functioning in this crisis is that people are talking on all sides of the issue of the Shah, and they should continue to do so.
Understanding that everybody agrees on the central point and repeats that fact that there will be no yielding, there are no Americans of any standing in any community that want to see us do anything. There's been no cry that I've heard in this country saying that whatever our disagreements may have been about the history preceding his being here, that we should trade the Shah for the hostages. I think that the amazing thing is that, in fact...
Well, let me put it this way. Suppose you were in Congress right now, and suppose, searching your own conscience, you arrived at the conclusion that the Shah actually should be sent to Tehran even as Eichmann got there, to be sure he was apprehended under different circumstances, but they should go down there and be tried. But you were convinced that if you got up and made a speech to that effect, it would get huge display in Iran, and the effect of it would be a little bit like the effect of the people who kept disparaging the Vietnam War on Hanoi. They're coming around, so we'll just hang on to the hostages, you watch. Would you not let considerations of prudence dictate whether you happened to speak what was on your mind at that particular moment?
It's inconceivable that anybody, in my mind, would decide that we should trade the Shah for the hostages, let alone, in other words, I can't conceive if
well,
I consular, believed it.
Consular is in favor of
oh,
it.
Oh, come on.
No, no, but
what
you're asking
mean,
me
on.
If I were
come on, what is that supposed to represent, though?
Well, he said it's inconceivable.
You're asking if I were in Congress, and I'm just saying that I think in terms of the elected people in this country, to think that there would be anyone in an elective office who would believe that we ought to submit to that kind of blackmail is inconceivable. So if you're asking me, what would I do if something I can't conceive of were to occur? I don't know. But I believe that the fact is that you should feel the same sense of triumph over the possibility that Kunstler, if he takes that position, speaks for any segment of this country, that we all should. That is not a position that the American people would elect anybody to office, let alone support them if they were once there.
Indeed, if I can add to that, it is the same issue as if you were Ronald Reagan, and someone said to you, you know, if you come out for granting the Shah permanent asylum, you may be endangering those hostages, because it may be believed that the United States is going to permanently shelter a man who their captors believe to be the world's worst human being. Mm-hmm. And whether that's true or false, do you want to give red meat to those captives? It's interesting that Reagan's statement has virtually escaped the kind of press condemnation that
as did Andy Young.
Yes, that Kennedy's got. So, did he have a right to say that? Should he not have said that because of the crisis?
No, I think it's different for the following reasons. He's trying there to take a position which, in the first place, is hardly novel. It's the position that Kissinger associated with Kissinger during the last 9 months. Secondly, I think he's trying to say to other people in the world, look, if you are friends of ours now, not only, I'm running for president of the United States, not only is it my position that we shouldn't eject the Shah in reaction to this blackmail, it is my position that this will be a sanctuary for people who have been friends of the United States.
That's not what I asked. I said, if you can reasonably conclude that that might have further endangered the safety of those 50 Americans, which, after all, is the fundamental premise on which we are supposed to remain united on this issue. And I'm saying that if one concedes to Reagan, and I believe you're right, that's a perfectly logical argument.
Or the fundamental basis of the criticism of Kennedy was that it would jeopardize...
Right, but my point, Bill, is that the need to assuage present allies about our future intentions may have been a legitimate reason for taking a step which could reasonably be concluded to endanger the hostages. Similarly, if Senator Kennedy believed that our policy as a general proposition had been to support, aid, and comfort people we ought not to have been doing in positions of leadership, then the same thing applies.
No, because in the one case it's redundant. That is to say, the Iranians are totally familiar with the so-called Kissinger line.
But the Americans
are not. And
simply
to associate yourself with it is hardly inflammatory.
No,
as
witness
said, they didn't give it any headlines.
But may I say, we're not talking to the Iranians. We're talking among ourselves. I have very many times in my life heard people say we shouldn't really talk about that because it will endanger national security. That kind of thing is a very dangerous premise in a democracy. In this particular situation, it is your guess that the Kennedy statement might endanger the hostages, and it might be somebody else's guess that the Reagan statement might endanger the hostages. But in point of fact, these people are simply trying to discuss it on an internal discussion basis, and it's anybody's guess whether it'll help or hurt. And I would not at all be in favor of saying here is a taboo subject.
More than that, if the Iranians had been as pleased with Kennedy's statement as we have been told they were, which I believe we've been told for domestic political purposes, they would not have then tried to invent things that he didn't say. I mean, the fact of the matter is the Iranians, I think, have been trying to smear Kennedy by saying that he said things which in no way would he have remotely have said, because they wanted to create the impression that there was division when Kennedy's statement, in my view, reemphasize the unity on the central fact that there will be no yielding to the blackmail. You know what I'd like to say about the general topic,
though? Is this reference to the controlled press in the United States that all of a sudden has magnified what Teddy Kennedy said?
No, no, it's not a conspiracy of any kind. What it is it's a reaction that has been generated in the heat of a campaign.
It's a reaction to very bad judgment.
It's a reaction to a statement which, made at the time and in the way that it was subject to the kind of interpretation that led to the difficulties that you're describing. But if you get past the interpretation of it and look at what the merits are of Schlesinger's comments on discussing the topic, I do think that you come back to this, that there are very serious problems about our foreign policy, some of which we've agreed about. I would hope we would talk some about the errors that we've made in dealing with the Rhodesia crisis, which is less compelling because there are no American hostages, but in its own way is just as much of a time bomb, mm-hmm. ticking in a major part of the world where the government of this country followed policies that I think need to be held accountable for. Now, to say that, given that fact, that foreign policy ought to be almost off limits, even on a subject where there is unanimity of feeling on the question of blackmail, but that therefore that unanimity of feeling precludes honorable discourse on other aspects of how we got into that situation or what we do to choreograph our way out, because the central fact is that to get these guys out of there is going to require a choreograph, and that choreograph ought to be discussed privately, not publicly.
Yeah, yeah.
And any choreograph discussed privately is subject to all of the vicissitudes that you know from your experience at the UN and elsewhere. You can't even tell from a distance what's going on. But to silence public opinion in sort of, I just think it's a mistake.
Let's leave it and go mm-hmm. on to Rhodesia, but let me just say this. I think really it's a matter of taste, but taste, as Stendhal once said, bad taste can lead to murder. And just as Jesse Jackson, having been shown the shrine to the Holocaust in Israel, says, well, there were 30 million blacks who were killed, was a collapse of taste, the consequences of which were extremely offensive at a political level to his host. So I think it is a matter of taste that causes you to decide whether to bring up a particular subject at a particular time. But on Rhodesia, since Al Lowenstein has been so active on that theater, it might be interesting to put him on the record as to whether he thinks the solution that was enacted in London is one that's going to work.
Well, I can't predict that it will work, but I certainly think it's a solution that makes the best possible opportunity for something to work, and that the skill with which Lord Harlech and Lord Carrington and the British government in general conducted the negotiations is evidence that no matter how difficult a situation appears to be, when the time is right and if the catalysts are right, solutions at least have a chance to succeed that other people for a long time said were impossible. It isn't a year ago that we were told that there was no way that the war in Rhodesia could be ended, that it was going to go on not only till the internal settlement people collapsed, but also till Mugabe and Nkomo settled their differences through a war. The ricochet of that on Namibia and on South Africa was clear, and the sense that the whole of Southern Africa was in for a very major bloodshedding was accepted by very wise people who thought they knew all about the facts. Those who dissented from that approach and said it's never right to assume that killing must go on when there's a chance to stop it, and it's never right to assume that we're powerless to influence events when we have a major role through sanctions and what could be done, that position prevailed. And it turns out that at least there's now a very real possibility that something which the Patriotic Front has accepted and which Muzorewa has accepted along with the whites inside Rhodesia can give peace an opportunity to let democratic process choose the next government in Zimbabwe.
Well, they might choose it for a week, or for 2 weeks, or for 9 months. But don't we have a Kerensky type situation in which nothing happened in London nobody performed a prefrontal lobotomy on Nkomo and Mugabe, and what they have said is that they are Marxist revolutionaries, especially Mugabe, and he's going to take over. Now, he's not going to stop fighting simply because a ridiculous democratic ritual says that he's not the most popular man around. He's going to continue to fight to the extent that the Soviet Union wants to exploit that possibility the way it's exploiting its possibilities in other theaters in the world. Are we, in fact, dedicated to enforcing the results of that election in Rhodesia? We once became pretty famous for saying that we were going to enforce democratic procedures in South Vietnam. That didn't last for all that long, but it was very bloody.
If Muzorewa had been left alone without an agreement and a return to legality, without sanctions lifted in this country and by Britain, without Cohen and Nyerere and the frontline president supporting the formula that they've now arrived at, the chances of that internal settlement lasting against the combined military forces that were closing in and the economic sanctions from the rest of the world, it seems to me, were non-existent.
Of course.
But there's a totally different scene.
Which was an argument for lifting sanctions.
Well, it was an argument for lifting sanctions if you assume that that by itself would have brought some kind of resolution that would have been democratic. But as we've discussed this before at length, my feeling then was and is now that the use of sanctions as the leverage to produce the kind of changes in the internal settlement that made it acceptable to the frontline presidents and the democratic, our kind of democratic forces around the world was a very important set of changes. And that the Patriotic Front recognized the fact that once those changes were coming about, they'd better get on board, no matter how hypocritically, because otherwise they could not win the war. Now, my hope is that it's not hypocritical, that they will accept the fact that given the change in military and economic circumstance, for them to try to achieve power by war is going to be unsuccessful, and that they're therefore going to play the game by the rules that Lloyd Soames is going to enforce. I can't guarantee that. There's no guarantee of the future. But I do think that if you believe in democratic process, it's in much better shape in Rhodesia now than it would have been without this conference and without the support for it that has come from the African countries around Zimbabwe.
You seem to be juxtaposing your question with some hypothetical perfect situation or solution in your mind. I would like to ask you, if that's permitted, what you think would have been a better way than this way. I mean, the situation, like many situations we face in this country, has no 100% clear solution. But this solution would seem to be the most workable one, given all the hypotheses. What would you have preferred?
Well, I would have preferred a public statement to the effect that we do not consider that the ambitions of Nkomo and Mugabe can be described as democratic, and that under the circumstances, the same kind of treatment that is appropriate for guerrilla fighters is appropriate for them. I would back the Muzorewa government on the grounds that it was a manifestation at least as better as that of any of its neighbors, and much better than most.
But you would have ended up then with the collapse of that government in due course. Seriously, there was no way, given the united hostility of the African continent, dependent only on South African assistance, and with the increased sense among the whites left in Rhodesia that the war was going to go on forever and therefore they might as well get out. The simple military and psychological fact was that that would have ended up, in my view, within a year with a collapse of the internal settlement. And therefore, what I think Harriet's saying is right, that there was we were not discussing eudaimonia, we were discussing Zimbabwe, and that in that situation, many, many people who were very critical of what some of us said when we came back from the elections, that we had to support those elections as a part of an ongoing process, that was an important step showing the African people in that country wanted to have an end of the war. That position, which was assailed as racist by well-intentioned people and by doctrinaire people at the time, was a position which, in my view, ended up being perceived correctly as the one hope there was of having democratic process to resolve the differences. And at this stage, even the Patriotic Front, for whatever reason, has signed on board. Now, I believe that most of the people fighting for the Patriotic Front were doing so because they didn't want a racist government imposed on them. And I think that they, whatever the individuals may feel that may be in positions of leadership, are going to support a democratic process. And that no matter what else happens, it isolates those who want war for its own sake or want power no matter what the prices you pay to get it. So if we care about the end of the difficulties in Southern Africa having some chance of occurring without terrible catastrophe, we've got to support the fact that groups have to be brought back in who have been revolutionary under circumstances where revolution was justified by the absence of any hope of ending oppression in any other way. And I think
I'm in favor of assimilating all assimilable bodies.
Okay. Well, this is a way to find out.
And
isn't it?
If the Ku Klux Klan were assimilable, I'd be all in favor of assimilating it. So occasionally you find unassimilable bodies, then you've got a problem. Let me ask Jeff here. Perhaps you noticed in Commentary magazine a review of Senator Kennedy's voting record on all foreign matters in the last 9 or 10 years. Mm-hmm. From that survey emerges an interesting fact. Number one, he has been with that small minority of the Senate that had voted more or less consistently against any effort to modernize our military. Number two, that rhetoric with which he assails people who violate human rights tends to be reserved for those countries that are allied with us, there is this conspicuous absence of any excoriation by Senator Kennedy of those countries that opposes most conspicuously, of course, Soviet Union, mm-hmm. China, Cambodia, and so forth. Now, since obviously he's not a fellow traveler, what is it that causes this isolation of Senator Kennedy from the mainstream of his own colleagues in the Democratic Party?
I love the way those questions are phrased. It's wonderful. I should first say that in working for Robert Kennedy in 1968, I did not sign on as a family retainer. I regard that obligation as that one.
Discharged.
Yes. But I do think that those are two different questions. To equate the opposition to the kind of defense programs that come regularly before the Senate with opposition to modernizing the army, or modernizing the armed forces, is a statement that can be attributed without looking at specifics. I mean, the quality of...
Well, that's why this commentary article sought to be very fair by simply saying how many Democrats voted for this, how many didn't.
I know, but the fact of the matter...
He was always with the very small McGovern.
Yes, but which proves nothing about the merits. What it does prove is that over the 1970s have been a time when close to a majority in the United States Senate coalition against increased defense spending has shrunk, and it has shrunk largely, I think, because the Soviet Union has become such a justifiable target of hostility that it's okay for liberals to now be for defense spending. I mean, that's a very complicated thing, but it's happened. But that and so one of the things that happens is that it is possible to hold hostage, if you should pardon the expression, a working majority of the Congress toward any measure which is preceded by the name defense or national security. And if my point is not that Senator Kennedy was right or wrong about it, but that it is impossible to describe those kinds of votes without knowing what the programs were. For instance, you remember the Maine battle tank? That was a modernizing tool of the new army, the Maine MBT-70. It was a multi-tens of million dollar all-electronic tank, a wonder. Margaret Chase Smith found that it took someone 3 feet 6 inches tall to fit into it. Now, you could say that voting against that was voting against modernizing the army. You could also say that it was against the kind of things
that you're playing games.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
Because I'm not talking about voting against eccentric measures. I'm talking about voting against measures that practically every other senator voted in favor
but
of.
But all that says is that in the Gulf of Tonkin was voted against by two senators. That's not a measure of the quality. But the more interesting point, I think, if I may say, is the question of the double standard about human rights. Because on this one, I think that there has been among the left in general a breakdown in what I would call, you know, the proper neutral principle, namely that if your foot is on someone else's neck, you are quite wrong. Jack Newfield and I did a book 7 years ago which got great hostility from parts of the left, because that was our argument, that when it comes to democracy or human rights, we don't care what the label of the government is. And indeed, I think it true that there has been a kind of laziness, if I could put it that way, on the part of liberals, that what one assails when it comes to human rights is Chile, which certainly deserves it, in my judgment, or Paraguay, which deserves it.
Don't forget Argentina.
But Argentina, yes, these are wretched governments. But that the Soviet Union, with 200 plus million people, is a government that is unbelievably
wretched. But what is the left? I'm not sure what that means. I think that there's a laziness on the part of some people, left or right, whatever those labels mean, in selective denunciations.
I was coming to that.
But
I find the same laziness on the part of the Reagans and Connollys of this world, that one must endorse the Somozas of this world as a way of preserving American allies. The principle of being against the suppression of human rights is one that, I mean, you go back to Orwell and you can find brilliant indictments of those people who are selective, who play ideological games.
May I say, I'd like to say a couple of things. First of all, of course, I agree with the general statement that you've just made, that suppression of human rights should be resisted and objected to wherever it occurs.
Well, no, you don't mean resisted, because that's what we tried to do in Vietnam.
No, suppression of human rights should be resisted.
But not if it involves the use of one American Marine, right?
No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking strictly about the fact that where human rights are in jeopardy,
we should resist it
metaphorically. Up. We should speak up on it. And I wondered at one time whether speaking up made any difference until I heard the testimony of one of the members of the commission that went to South Africa in connection with the man who was murdered there. His name
Beto.
That's right. Beto at the moment. And I can assure you from what he and subsequently other people have said, speaking up in favor of human rights is a very important function for this government, and we have, for this country, not this government, and we have discharged it with good effect in many instances. But I would like also very briefly to address your two questions. The fact that a person is a small minority in the Senate may prove that he's the only person with his colleagues who has any vision, or it may prove that he has seen something that somebody else hasn't seen. I think you're quoting that Senator Kennedy has been in a small minority on a variety of bills means nothing one way or the other. I can think of a lot of flattering interpretations of that fact, and I think Jeff has given some of those.
Well, if you believe in unilateral disarmament, I can too.
No, no, come on. Talk about playing games. You can't draw conclusions on the merits from the fact that he's in a minority. You haven't looked at what the issues are. Maybe he's wrong. You don't mind
a moment ago you were making generalities about the Reagans and the Connollys not condemning Somoza often enough. Why can't I make generalities about the fact that Kennedy only becomes a hawk when he addresses Israel bond rallies?
No, by the way,
apropos of that, may I ask you something?
That was a very sharp turn there, by the way. I mean, you are going to come back to this point.
Yeah, yeah. I knocked over a few garbage cans on the way.
And, it's amazing,
you have a wonderful way of catalyzing my thoughts.
Well, a man who got 14% of the vote when he ran for mayor ought not to be so condemnatory about people in the minority. You may have been right about those issues.
I was ashamed by how many votes I got. It meant that I wasn't pure enough.
That's my point. Oh, is that right?
But let me ask Ms. Pilpel something. Everybody is more or less used to some of the vulgarities of the democratic process. If you go to the American Legion, you put on your American Legion hat and you give a patriotic speech and you denounce traitors, right? And you come out in favor of veterans' benefits.
Why did you look at me when you said traitors? I'm very disturbed about that.
Then if you go to a farmers' convention, you say, we certainly don't want any diminution in the price of wheat and so on and so forth. We're used to that kind of stuff, but certain people tend to say, well, this is the kind of stuff that's necessary to attract people less intelligent than us. Now, you take the Jewish community in New York City, and you consider its cultural and educational achievements. They're part of the population. They are overrepresented by a factor of 6, 7, or 8 in the top medical schools, colleges, and so on and so forth. They are, I think, the intellectual elite of the country. And yet, here comes Teddy Kennedy, and he comes and he addresses a $500 dinner in New York City. He's running for president. What does he do? He comes out for $350 million more for Israel. Now, why don't a few Jewish leaders get up and just walk out in disgust, on the grounds that they shouldn't be treated the way people are treated?
Mostly because they favor $350 million.
That's right.
I know. But the borderness of the gesture.
Okay, but why? Let me ask.
Is something that transcends the deed.
I'll tell you why. You paid $500 for a dinner. You don't walk out till you've finished.
Well, that's not the reason. I think one of the reasons is what Al said, and that is that because they're in favor of it. Another reason is that not everybody has your finely tuned sensitivities. And you talked before about a question of taste and so forth. I think when taste goes over into a field of principle, it's no longer taste, and you implied that conversely. I would say that since Kennedy was saying what these people thought ought to be done, there was no reason why they should resist it. I don't think this program ought to turn into an attack on or a defense of Senator Kennedy, so I'd like to go back to some other question that you asked.
You can always come back to Kennedy.
I'm sure you'll come back to Kennedy. It seems to be a compulsion
on your part. I will if you don't.
Okay.
But I'd like to go back to you saying why are we always appealing for human rights in countries that are sort of friends of ours, or I forget how you describe them.
Allies.
Mm-hmm. And not those who are in the Soviet bloc and so forth. One reason might be that we have various methods of supporting those governments which have been used to great disadvantage in the United States and in other countries. And therefore, many people who criticize regimes in countries where we are exporting a great deal of money and know-how and technology and so forth say, if we are going to be buttressing this government, that government ought to recognize some of the things that we in the United States believe to be essential to human freedom. We do not, with any substantial amount, buttress the other countries where we don't talk.
Except when Nixon sells them wheat at half the price that we have to pay for it. I mean, then you have a different situation. I want to talk about, if I may, just for a moment on the question of human rights, because that was something that...
Your specialty.
Right. And you would be the first, I think, to acknowledge that when I was at the Human Rights Commission, we did discuss oppression in the Soviet Union for the first time.
Yeah, first time in 23
first
years.
First time. Yeah. But my point in saying that is simply to say that I think that there's a, it's something too facile to say that liberals don't, conservatives do. I would like to say that I think that there is inherent in the approach to human rights of most of the political leaders of this country an opportunism which shatters the possibility of genuine progress across the board by people agreeing on the kind of formulation that we all know is right, namely that human rights is a concern regardless of where it occurs, where the violations occur. It can't be the only ingredient in foreign policy, but it ought to be one component, that there are things which modify what we can do about it. Everybody, well, Churchill once said that, I think it was when Hitler invaded the Soviet Union, that if Hitler invaded hell, the British, he would at least make a favorable reference to
deal with the devil.
Yeah.
So we know that other ingredients do occur in foreign policy and need to. But that at no point should we forget that a government which is willfully repressive of its own people ought to be the object of concern on the part of people everywhere else. Now, given the fact that people who share our values are not that numerous, that is to say, governments which share those values are not that numerous, there is a limit to what we can do. We can do more in some places than in others. We need to do more in some than in others because of the immediacy of the threat to our own security, which is an additional component. I think Kennedy's record on human rights has been pretty consistently sharing those universal values that you would share, that he is as concerned about oppression in communist countries as he is in other places. And I think it's really...
Why does he keep it a secret?
Well, I don't think he does. And I got to tell you that...
Well, maybe just his best friend, he tells.
I'll tell you what I think is the problem. I think that when this issue is joined, that just as people have a mindset about what Kennedy's going to say, they have a mindset about what conservatives are going to say, and they distill through that mindset, for instance, when you're talking before about his support for Israel, that is not a support that is the doctrinaire left position in this country, as you know. There's an awful lot of left support for the PLO.
I said he was trying to make points with the Jewish community in New York.
That's what I said, pure and simple.
I didn't say it was a left-wing position, because in the first place, American Jews in New York are not on the whole left.
No, I'm saying that the position of supporting Israel is a position which is not perceived as left. Mm-hmm. And therefore, when Kennedy takes that position, it's immediately an exception to the statement you made before that he is not as concerned about the issues where there are... it's a question.
He's going to become strange love before day after tomorrow. He came out for MX missiles yesterday.
Okay.
Talk about your 3-foot people and 2-foot tanks, whatever it is.
That would fit. No, it wouldn't.
It's like Senator Church or General Church.
But no, wait.
Could we
just back up?
He wants
for
to
one
invade
second.
Cuba at least until the 3rd of November, 1980.
If the issue is the hypocrisy of politicians, Douglas said, there are enough precedents to go around. But the point is this. First, one of the reasons why, in reading the congressional record, one can get a slightly distorted picture is because aid bills to the Soviet Union and Cuba don't come up. In other words, more often than not, what one is voting on in the Senate is packages of aid to allies, which tend to be oppressive. The opportunity then, in other words, we don't often send, except when Nixon sends wheat or goes to the ballet in Peking and doesn't say anything about what is depicted there, which a well-known conservative once wrote about.
Yes, waited for him to lurch into a toast to Alger Hiss, as I recall.
That's a wonderful line. Who wrote that line? Anyway, the point is that what one tends to vote on in the Senate is aid bills to allies, which also tend to be oppressive. And so that what one is commenting on is American policy, which tends to support governments of one type that are oppressive and not the other. I do not, however, want to be heard to deny the fact
that all politicians
all politicians are opportunists.
Wait a minute.
Except
you and me, and we're not in office.
That I do believe that one of the problems with liberalism in the United States has been a laziness about this issue of the nature of, quote, progressive governments which are also oppressive. The same on the right as with friendly governments which tend to be oppressive. I think it's a pandemic. I think that we don't talk very honestly because we tend to root. We tend to look at foreign countries the way we look at football teams. If you're for the Pittsburgh Steelers, they don't cheat. Now, I know that's
trivial.
I'd like
to dissent from that.
I am
involved with a number of organizations that are deeply concerned with human rights, and they have spoken up with reference to communist countries, non-communist countries, fascist countries, and so forth. Among those organizations are the civil liberties union groups, including the International League for the Rights of Man, Amnesty Incorporated, and so forth. It is totally unfair to say that those groups have either been quiet, or even, if I may say so, Jeff, they haven't been lazy either.
But those groups
they
are
have
ex-
sought
great
out.
Exceptions. Those are, you're talking about two honorable groups. I am saying that the rhetoric, the, I'm not talking about.
It depends
Adams.
What you mean by left. It really
I,
does.
I believe
really
that there does. Is, well, I will say, even on the mainstream, among mainstream liberals, there has been a kind of laziness about this issue. That when it comes to the Soviet Union, we tend to talk about cooperation more than the fact that it's a gulag state.
No, but I, don't.
I don't think that's so.
Let's give an example given in commentary. Senator Kennedy greatly praised Jamaica recently. Well, Jamaica, do we believe the Freedom House is impartial? Because I do.
No. No, I don't.
Well,
I'll just tell you that. It's not a dishonorable group, but I don't believe they're impartial.
It is alleged to be impartial, and I've never known anyone to document its impartiality. In any case, Jamaica has a lower rating on political rights than, it has almost as low ratings. It has 6 out of 7. By contrast, in a similar speech, referring, I think it was to, I forget, some Caribbean country. In any event, it showed that there was a list to port in his evaluation, which is consistent with
okay,
his record.
Okay, the only thing that, before we get too set on this one topic, when Gerald Ford disclaimed the possibility that countries in Eastern Europe lacked the kinds of freedom that we want or were under Soviet influence.
But that was a universally acknowledged faux pas.
No, but it was, what I'm saying, it was a mindset for the president, as you said in your column. Isn't the Amazon River in the United States? Don't you mean the Mississippi? No, I mean the Amazon, A-M-A-Z-O-N. It was a repeated statement, not a faux pas, by the president on television, which it seems to me one forgives him because one understands that that sort of thing happens and can be used to illustrate something which is unfair. Certainly Gerald Ford isn't soft on communist oppression because he made those statements. I think that the total record of Kennedy, just to finish that one topic and get to the more important one, which is not Kennedy, but I think the total record of Kennedy over a long period in public life is that he's not lazy about oppression wherever it occurs, that he does care about human rights, that he's had considerable courage on questions which were difficult in his own constituency, including being stoned because he took a position on the issue in Boston when it was an unpopular one. He was early on the side of the stronger position in the Middle East than some of the so-called liberals wanted to take when it was difficult. You may think that was because of constituency pressures. My point is simply to say that the overall record doesn't lend itself to the notion that he lists to the left on questions of this sort, of whatever the left is, any more than Gerald Ford's record would be fairly assumed to be summarized by the mistake he made when he made a statement. So if Kennedy's statement on Jamaica was a statement you find in error, have the same sense about that that you would about Ford on Poland.
There's an awful asymmetry in your pointing to the Ford statement, which was the universal laughing stock of the entire world the next day. And if Kennedy had said, oh, I didn't mean to talk about how wonderful things were in Jamaica, I was really talking about Ohio. Then that would be a comparable situation.
My point is, I don't know what he said on Jamaica. I can't comment on that. But you do know that, as a simple political fact, if the issue becomes distorted in this campaign to be that someone is soft on repressive governments when they're supposed to be left, when that, in fact, is a statement that does not reflect what their attitude is about repressive governments, we get back into a kind of campaigning which itself is not very useful. And that seems to me what we ought to be talking about.
I tell you what's not very useful at all is that we are faced in Iran with something that may bring on a third world war, and we are to a certain extent faced with that problem because the people who are running our foreign policy were so concerned over the civil rights of Iranians, which are now infinitely worse off than under the worst of the Shah's days. That combination threatens to blow the progress of Middle Eastern peace. It threatens to disrupt detente. It threatens to affect the SALT Treaty.
That's a criticism of Kennedy.
There is a kind of a purism which is incandescently shown in the postures of Senator Kennedy, which is terrifically relevant to what kind of a president he would make. He would welcome the deposition of every Shah in the world and his replacement by an Ayatollah, which is what tends to happen. It happened in Cuba.
It happened
in North Korea. It happened in China.
It happened in North Korea.
I could take any North Korea.
Sure.
I could take any presidential candidate.
Absolutely.
If I'd known that's what we were going to talk about today, I could take any presidential candidate, pick out the bad things he said and criticize them. And when, if by chance I found any good things, I could say what you do, well, that he's doing for public effect. I mean, he doesn't really mean that. He means the wrong things he said. He doesn't mean the right things he said. I mean, one thing that Senator Kennedy has done, which I think is extremely courageous and progressive, is that he has indicated that although he, for example, is opposed to abortion, he is also opposed to the right to life position, which says that everybody must be opposed to abortion, whether his conscience dictates that way or not. I don't think you can say he did that for political reasons, as I say, because anything that's good you will say was political. Anything that's bad you will say shows of evil nature.
No, I think he's a very sincere lefty.
That makes him a left? I mean, what I just said on abortion, that certainly does make him a left.
Is the Americans for Democratic Action a, is that a...
It's a liberal group.
Yeah, but is it...
Anti-communist liberal.
Yeah, but is it also reputable?
Yeah.
Okay. It says it gave Senator Kennedy a 100 rating.
Which means he's what?
Which means something.
Well, it means he's liberal.
That's right.
The word lefty is not quite the same.
Well, no, when you get 100%...
I mean, it's a difference between a friend and a crony.
Look, you can bring your own spectrum with you if you want. Roll your own. The spectrum today is something that reaches from, like, Senator Helms over here to Senator Kennedy over there. But the guy who's at the very end of that spectrum wants to be president of everybody.
But there are a lot of people to the left.
Where's Ronald Reagan on the spectrum?
And there are a lot of people to the left of Kennedy.
Now, there is a shift in the spectrum, as a result of which people like Reagan, and as a matter of fact, people like Goldwater, are up around here now.
Well, but you were there when they were over here.
The shift in what they say. Because
did you pick three lefties to be here today, though?
The fortuities of liberalism have become so manifest.
Are we three lefties?
The spectrum has moved.
You are equating liberals and leftists, and I really resent that. I'm perfectly willing to be both. But the fact that ADA gave Kennedy a 100 rating does not prove anything about whether he's a leftist. It proves probably that he's a liberal.
It proves that he's at the left end of the liberal spectrum. Now, you can call that lefty
or not. It does not. It proves that he is supported by liberals, not necessarily the left end of the
spectrum. When Ronald Reagan was in Maine, if that was the right, you know, up in Nova Scotia. What has that got to do with the merits of the case? Obviously, you've chosen this program to do a 60-minute, go too tall Jones on Ted Kennedy.
I didn't even have Kennedy's name
down
here.
Well, it sure came
up
a lot.
But it must have been in your mind.
You said.
I mean, it's right there.
Something you said.
You don't need to write him down to bring him up. That's all you chose.
I didn't write down a breathe either.
Before we end this program, we're on the verge of discussing something that would be much more useful than continuing what I believe to be an unfair statement about Ted Kennedy's general position, and which I'd be glad to talk about for an hour on its own merits.
Just let it be understood that when I say left, I don't mean communist. That's very clear, I hope you know.
Oh, yes.
I mean
left.
The left end of the liberal spectrum. Over there is the totalitarians.
Mm-hmm. And over Ronald there, Reagan is on the right end. Over there are the fascists, right?
And I'm not sure Ted Kennedy is on the left end of the liberal spectrum.
There are many similarities between Reagan and Nazis as there are between communists and Kennedy.
So what's the point?
You were trying to say that I said something a little bit
unfair,
naughty and unfair,
yes.
And I didn't say anything of the sort.
I don't think lefty.
Everything what I said was said with exquisite precision.
God, I hope
except not. What you said about the foreign policy in connection with Iran, but I agree, because there I think that your statement was so fallacious that it would take all the time we have left to demonstrate beyond the shadow of a doubt that it was not those who were in favor of human rights under the Shah who were responsible.
Let me ask you a specific question. I was sent to Nicaragua when I was involved with human rights. I went to Nicaragua. I talked to everybody I could find. I was almost lynched by a left-wing mob at the university, which I remember as it closed in on me thinking it takes a special kind of genius to be lynched by a left-wing mob in a right-wing dictatorship. I don't know who else has achieved that. But I came back and I said to everybody I could say it to, Nicaragua is going to have a revolution. There is no support left for Somoza except the guard. It will not be enough to keep him in. It is bad policy for us to bank on Somoza. Did that make me lefty or soft on reality to say, apart from the humanitarian concept, let me finish the question. Isn't it fair to say that there is an assessment that you make in a hard-headed, practical way, quite apart from whatever emotional involvement one may have with liberty or whatever else, about the reality of a situation? And I believe that that situation in Nicaragua required a policy reflecting what people there wanted for our own interests. Now, I felt the same way about oppression in communist countries, as you will know, and said that as well. But you see, what I'm saying is that if you put this simple overlay that if you criticize repressive governments because they've been friendly to us at the UN or whatever, you end up with a test which is inconsistent with our national interest, in my view. And what I'd like to ask you before we finish the discussion of the year without ever getting to it.
Are we through with Nicaragua?
Well, I'm just worried that we're almost through the program.
The distinction there is between political angelism, which is the game you tend to play, let's make everything perfect tomorrow, and political meliorism. I think, for instance, that South Africa is going in the right direction. When you write, when you see the Minister of Justice writing to the New York Times, say, "I think my country is unjust," I think you're really getting someplace.
That'd be fair. Do you think that my position on Rhodesia was angelism?
What's that?
Was my position on Rhodesia angelism or muterism?
No, it was not.
Because I would argue with you that if we could take each subject and had time to take each subject, you would discover that I am not looking to or expecting perfection or overnight changes. I want very much meliorism. Absolutely right. I think the phrase is right. I think the approach is right. But I think that one has to be clear about the degree of oppression and difficulty one's dealing with and how much time one has.
Right.
Lots of
and
other
what
questions.
The alternatives are.
And what the alternatives
yes.
are.
Go ahead now.
Now, the question I really wanted to get to, if I can just take a second, is that we've sort of tottered on toward the question of politicians saying very little as they run, no matter who they are. And I think that's an indictment that applies to most politicians in most campaigns, and it is compounded by the fact that everybody now spends 90% of their money on television, where it's very difficult to say anything in 30 seconds or 1 minute that means anything. I think that's true of every candidate for president right now, and I think it's sad. And I would agree with you that if we could discuss why, as politics descends into that level of non-discussion, why that's a terrible problem in a society faced with great crises. 52% of the people in this country now receive assistance from the government compared to 48%. I mean, how is that going to continue? What are we going to do about energy? Why don't we put a dollar tax on gas so we can begin to conserve instead of waste? I mean, all these topics about which I think we ought to be talking in this campaign are not being discussed by any candidates. And if we discuss the year 1979, or prospectively the next campaign, without dealing with those questions instead of the sort of simplistic slogans about who's left or who's right, I think we've done a disservice to the public
dialogue. I couldn't agree with you more, but are you saying that nobody who's running for president has taken positions on any of these
subjects?
Well,
I say that most of them in the end sound like a blur. That it's part of the process that we seem to have arrived at of everything getting homogenized into, I mean, the press will say Reagan's moving to the center, Kennedy's moving to the center, everybody's moving here and there. But what really does happen, it seems to me, is that there is, not just for president, but for Congress, for every position, there is an increased disinclination to have discourse on subjects. And it would be much more important on a program like this, which is one of the few genuinely useful programs I think that exist, because it brings people together to discuss ideas, to talk about the question of what do we do about the inflation and energy questions in a presidential year. How do we get a country which is capable of such magnificent conduct out of the terrible slot that's led us to the position we are now, where everybody is more parochial, more self-seeking, not just politicians, but the public and all the communities that constitute that mosaic. What is it we do to try to raise that in this year so that we discuss not only individuals for president, but the nature of the civilization we're trying to build?
I think you're right. Unhappily, I have to say good night. But we have had several hours on energy and intend to have more. Thank you very much, Allard Lowenstein, Mrs. Harriet Pilpel, and Jeff Greenfield, ladies and gentlemen.
Bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.